Boa noite, mais uma vez, os encontros do mundo em Lisboa estão aqui no canal Matriz Portuguesa, sábado. Desta feita, convidámos a senhora embaixadora Helena Pilsen, embaixadora da Suécia em Portugal, para nos falar sobre a Suécia, sobre a comunidade residente sueca em Portugal e também sobre o seu programa cultural, económico, científico, etc. É um país que tem, desde há muitos anos, há muitos séculos, uma ligação diplomática de tratados de paz, tratados económicos e até religiosos, de liberdade de culto entre os nossos dois países. Ambassador, thank you very much for accepting our invitation. This technology allows us to have this conversation through the internet, since during this pandemic, and Sweden, as Portugal and all our neighbors and all over the world, we are experiencing this new order, new reality. Let's start by talking about our relations between Portugal and Sweden. For instance, at the very first time, the very first year, when Portugal became independent from the Kingdom of Spain in 1641, Queen Cristina has received our embassy, and they had signed a treaty of friendship, freedom of navigation, trade, and religious worship was established for the subjects of each of these countries and in each territory. And since then, we have established this amiable relationships. Really, even our king, Louis the First, was a very dear friend of the king Oscar the Second. They traveled around to each country, even in Palácio de Nacional da Ajuda. There are all the Swedish orders offered, granted by the king. So this is indeed a long story, at least 400 years of diplomatic stories and relationships between our countries.
Yes, of course. Thank you very much, first of all, for the invitation. And just like you're saying, I mean, the diplomatic relations between Sweden and Portugal are very long-standing. We're not really made 400 years yet, but we're getting close. So we are reaching. We should be reaching 380 by 2021. And just like you were mentioning in your introduction, also, of course, it started out. Not least with the trade relations. So this is Portugal and Sweden. It's when it comes to our record of diplomatic relations, it's one of the countries with whom we have had the longest relations and also broad relations covering a range of topics, but starting out, like you mentioned, also with the trade relations.
And even so, when Portugal became a republic, Sweden as well immediately recognized the Portuguese Republic as an equal pair of a nation. And in 1975, there was, after our revolution as well, there was another treaty assigned, Declaration on Economic and Social Cooperation, signed in Lisbon, here in Lisbon. So each time there is a change in our not government, in our status, political status, and so on. Sweden wants immediately to proclaim that it wants to be a friend of Portugal. Is this true?
I mean, that's the relations all throughout, as you have mentioned also, they have been friendly relations, and I think it's also friendly relations in the broad sense. I mean, it could be, of course, it is on a governmental level, but it is also like we Like we can see on the people to people basis, Swedish people living here, as you know, we have had Portuguese people coming to Sweden throughout throughout the times, and it seemed to be to nationalities or people that get along. There are similarities that get along very well with each other.
And what are the agenda, the programs of the embassy in the areas such as economics, diplomatic, as you know as well, but economics, cultural, scientific, academics, and so on?
The embassy, as most of our embassies, is a small embassy. We have three sent outs, six local employees, and we also work very closely together with our chamber of Portuguese-Swedish Chamber of Commerce that is co-located with the embassy. So when I think of the three, I mean, the three main parts or the three main topics is first of all, our bilateral relations, and I would say not least our bilateral relations anchored in the fact that we're members of the European Union, and which has been important and is even more important now, considering the fact that we are like-minded on very issues, and as also the number of members in the European Union has become first larger and then smaller. So I think this is also looking forward towards the Portuguese presidency of the European Union, and thereafter the Swedish, not directly after, but in 2023, the Swedish presidency in the European Union. This is really the backbone of today's relations. It's the fact that we are members of the European Union and we think alike on many EU issues. That's one part of our job. The trade relations, like we started out talking, are long-standing, and that is really how, as you mentioned yourself, how our relations started. They started with the trade. We have a chamber, as I mentioned, the Portuguese Swedish or the Swedish Portuguese Chamber of Commerce, that has more than 100 members. Most of these are the most well-known Swedish companies or companies with Swedish roots that are today global companies, but also a number of newcomers, smaller companies, startups, and so on. So this is also, like you're mentioning, relations change with time, and here it's the same. We have the old companies that are members, the traditional companies, but also more of these newcomers and people moving here with a laptop and starting out a business. And as there's a large startup community also in Portugal, that's another part of like-mindedness. So that's the trade relations. We can get back to that also. And then the third part is, of course, catering for the Swedes, the consular work, which of course is focused on the Swedish tourists and the needs that they have when they come here. And this is a very popular. Portugal is a fantastic place for tourists to come in, and that is also the understanding of the many Swedes. Now, of course, it's exceptional times right now, as we all know, but generally we have more than 180,000 Swedish tourists visiting Portugal, which is quite a large number, visiting Portugal and different parts of Portugal each year. And now I'm just talking about the tourists who come here for a shorter period of time. So these are the three main parts of our work, the political, the European Union, the trade relations, and then, of course, the work that we are bound to do by law, which is not least catering for the Swedish citizens who come here to visit.
Since Sweden is a land of sailors as well, it's a long story of sailors and Portugal as well. You have, I believe, an important agenda in your country, in science, in technology, regarding this matter. Now that the oceans are in catch the agenda or the eye of the world, not only because of the climate changes, but also because of the energy, sustainable energies, and perhaps in the oceans there will be another answer for the food of the planet, and so on. So is there a special program that Sweden and Portugal, because we have as well several programs running in our country. Is there a special cooperation in some of these cases?
There's not, I mean, I think that's one of the areas where we also think very much alike and work along the same lines, is that the oceans, just like for Portugal, for Sweden, the oceans are important, but there the backbone is really also the multilateral cooperation, and not least within the United Nations, where we have, where Sweden co-hosted the first international conference of the oceans together with Fiji a few years back, and of course now we know that the idea was that the second one should be hosted here in Portugal, co-hosted together with Kenya in Lisbon in the spring. Of course, for obvious reasons, it could not happen. It has been, but my understanding is that it's not cancelled. That it would be it's postponed for the future. So and. That is definitely an area where we have an interest, and also I think common views when it comes. I mean, both, like you're mentioning, there are different parts of this. Of course, it's the ecological part. It's the trade. It is also the food for the future and the necessity of catering for the oceans. Of course, both the oceans which you are very familiar with, but also. Which, of course, is a special concern for us. It's also, of course, the situation in the Baltic Sea, if you look backwards. So, absolutely, this is an issue of common interest, but there's no bilateral. It is dealt with more on a multilateral than a bilateral level.
And what about the cultural in the artistic level? Is there been developed some or presented some exhibitions, some meetings between Swedish artists and Portuguese artists, special events in Portugal to present Swedish art or artists?
No, that's. I mean, that is something, of course, which is good, which is fantastic. We are pro cooperation in all forms, but then that is then done directly between. Could it be museums? It can be art galleries and so on. It is not something that the embassy is organizing. Sometimes, and we can help out, we can support, but this, of course, this is the main stakeholders are the artists or the museums themselves. But when it comes to the promotion, we think a lot about. Promoting central values, what we also think alike on many aspects. We had, for example, an exhibition in Funchal in Madeira in the spring on gender equality. We had an exhibition here a while ago on Swedish dads, fathers catering for their children, both in Sweden and in Portugal. So the promotion is linked to central traditions and also to promoting values.
And to come to this special situation of the world that we have sometimes been pointing out, Sweden has chosen to keep a special or a unique way concerning this pandemic, not expressing the confinement as we, for instance, in Portugal did. Of course, we close everyone at home. There's a small chance to be infected, of course, but. We know that this pandemic has several ways and several waves and so on and so on. At this point, I believe all the countries are experiencing the new experience. Shall I, if you excuse me the repetition, this coming again to open society for economics, but we are experiencing our exposure as well for the virus. What's the reality now of the Swedish reality? Do you Swedish people face this with optimism, but of course with caution?
No, I think here, I mean, one thing for both for Sweden and for Portugal, and which we share with most countries in the world, of course, is to cater for the people. I mean, we are of course concerned about the situation. That the main concern is about the people and caring for their health and for their safety. I think important thing to remember here when we're looking at the way this has been dealt with, this situation in Portugal or in Sweden or in other countries, is that one also has to think of the fact of how the countries are governed and what the law and what the constitution says. And in Sweden, according to the Swedish constitution, it is not possible for the government to do a lockdown, which is possible in other countries. It's only possible in Sweden in the case of war or in the imminent case of war. So the way Sweden is governed, it works with independent authorities, like in this case, on authority which is would be comparable to your DGS. And then these authorities make recommendations. And then, of course, the idea is that people should, in most cases also do, follow the recommendations, you know, of course, to the same precautions that are taken here also when it comes to social distancing. It is now also, we are concerned about the situation, of course, for the elderly population, and it has thus not been possible for people, for example, to visit their older parents or relatives in old age homes. But of course, the COVID obviously is a concern also for us. And life has changed in Sweden as well. Schools have been closed for the older children, but the younger children have been going to school during this whole period. So there's a difference, for example.
And what are the reality and what is the present day or the day by day for the Swedish community in Lisbon? They are still, they came back, they returned to Sweden, they remained in Portugal. Are they working mainly in Swedish enterprises, firms, or they do have their own enterprises or their own firms in Portugal, or work for Portuguese firms?
It's a mixture of people, like, you know, so we have Swedish people and more people, Swedish people living in Portugal, like you were saying. I mean, some live
in Lisbon or
I would say that the two main areas are outside of Lisbon and also along the southern coast and the Algarve. Some live here all year round. Others live here during the winter, which is, when it comes to the climate, very very pleasant, and then return to Sweden for the summer. Some are retired. Some drive their vans or whatever and spend the winter here and then drive back to Sweden. You also have younger families who come here. They come for a year. They set up their own companies, like you were mentioning, laptop companies, and then they like it and they stay on. So, I mean, we have different people and different categories of people also. And I think it's important to mention also that there is a Swedish school in Carcavelos outside of Lisbon from kindergarten until sixth grade. So when the children are 12, 13 years old. And they have a large number of applications. People coming here with their families and with their children, and some stay for a few years, and others like it very much, and then they just stay on.
I didn't know that there was a Swedish school.
Yeah, I wanted to mention it because most many people here don't know about it. Of course, it's not.
Is it recent?
No, just turned 60 a few years ago. So it's been around for 60 years. But I want to mention that it really started out as a very small school linked. I think that the first children were children of people who were working for the airlines, both Swedish and I think Norwegian. And of course, then the school has grown. So for me, it's I think it's important to remember when we talk about the Swedish presence here. It's obviously it's the embassy, it's the honorary consuls and our honorary consulates that we have on the Algarve in Porto, in the Azores, in Madeira, and also in Cape Verde that we cater for. It's also the chamber and it's the Swedish school, and there are a number. Many of the Swedish people living here are very active, so they are a number of organizations and clubs and whatever. So there's a large and active Swedish presence here, I would say.
So it's a very complex representation of the Swedish people and society in Portugal, in all the aspects, in all the areas of the life in society.
I think one interesting thing, for example, there is an association, it's a global organization, it's called Svea. It's an association for Swedish women around the world. It's a global organization. And the fastest growing section, if one can call it that, of the Svea is the one in Portugal. So there are lots of Swedish women, professional women who live here, and many also continue their professional activity. I mean, like you and I are saying, when we're talking today, these days you can continue your business even at a distance. You don't physically need to be in Sweden in order to do your business.
So what started in the 17th century still remains, because if there was a need for a treaty for religion and worship reasons for both countries in each territory, it meant that there was a considerable number of Swedish subjects living in Portugal. Indeed, it is quite a long story or history of relationship between not only the countries, the nations, but also the people. And this is very constant in our history, in our both history, in our common history, and it's very, very interesting. Ambassador, I let me tell you one small curiosity.
Yes, please.
In the 90s of the last century, I started a Swedish course in Lisbon, here in Lisbon, but I didn't finish. I hadn't the time, and I found that this language was enormously easy to learn, because it was a mix of English for us. Of phonetics and so on, a mix of English and German a bit, and but the most attractive thing, it was the accent. It was almost singing, and it was very, very, very nice. It was a school, I don't know if it still exists, near Marquês de Pombal, and the director was a Swedish man, and the school taught in Swedish, Norwegian, near London. I don't know the name, the language from the Netherlands.
Oh yeah, Dutch.
Dutch, yes. And it was very interesting for me to know that there were several languages from the northern countries that were taught in Portugal, but I didn't know that the presence of this community and the Swedish school was already present in Lisbon. Ambassador, it was a pleasure for us to receive you at our program. As you know, these programs on the internet are meant to be short. And afterwards, we are going to finish this little program with the small movie that you offered us for us to share to all our viewers about Sweden. Thank you very much, Ambassador, for your kind presence. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Foi mais um Encontros do Mundo, desta feita com a senhora embaixadora Helena Pilsas da Suécia em Portugal. Espero que tenham gostado e aprendido que as relações entre Portugal e a Suécia são tão longínquas quanto a nossa independência de 1640. Obrigado, boa noite.